What a privilege it is to pastor a church with young ladies like that that love the Lord, love their family, love His church, and use their talents and abilities to glorify Him. Great job, Gracie. This morning we're going to be in Psalm 61. The title of the message is The Rock That Is Higher Than I. Psalm 61. Last week we were in Cracker Barrel and I was up at the front area to pay our bill. And I saw a plaque there, and it said, "Crazy doesn't run in our family, it practically gallops." My first thought as I read that plaque was not that we need to have that for our home. My first thought was actually, I wonder if they sell that in bulk so I can get all of them. Crazy doesn't run in our family, it practically gallops. For many of us, perhaps even all of us, the day-to-day challenges of life and family are enough. It's enough to bear the day-to-day challenges. This psalm, Psalm 61, was written during an extremely challenging time. So I want to just elevate kind of the day-to-day challenges. You think about if you're a child or you're a family and parents, the challenges of school itself. Now imagine the challenges elevated with having to do school during a quarantine. Imagine the stresses of work day after day, only now the challenge is elevated. There's no longer stress at work because you've just lost your job. Imagine the challenges day after day of watching a child or a grandchild go down the wrong path. You've reminded them over and over again, this path will lead to destruction. Only now it's 1 a.m., and you just got a phone call and they're in jail. You think about the challenges that COVID has brought for our senior adults. The day-to-day challenges of elective surgeries and the day-to-day challenges of watching and saying goodbye to friends and family members, now coupled with hospital restrictions and restrictions on funeral homes and visitations. It's those moments in life beyond the day-to-day challenges that we face. It's those moments in life that will lead us to ask, God, do you really have everything under control? I know we sing that you've got the whole world in your hands, but my little pocket of the world right now seems to be really out of control. That's where David was when he was inspired by God to write this psalm. It was a time of extreme challenge for David. If you go back, and maybe you've already read it, or you'll read it this afternoon, 2 Samuel 15 through 18 provides the context for where David was as he wrote this. Within his own family, there had been sexual assault. There had been murder. There had been rebellion. David was out of the kingdom. His son was trying to overthrow him to be the new king. And David, driven from home, in a time of significant challenge in his life, got alone with God, inspired by God, and he writes these words, "Lead me to the rock that is higher than I." Look to your Bible, Psalm 61, as we read, "To the chief musician on a stringed instrument, a psalm of David. Hear my cry, O God, attend to my prayer. From the end of the earth I will cry to you. When my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. For you have been a shelter for me, a strong tower from the enemy. I will abide in your tabernacle forever. I will trust in the shelter of your wings. For you, O God, have heard my vows. You have given me the heritage of those who fear your name. You will prolong the king's life, his years as many generations. He shall abide before God forever. Oh, prepare mercy and truth, which may preserve him. So I will sing praise to your name forever, that I may daily perform my vows." Let us pray. Kind and gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for your word. Father, we thank you, Lord, that as we read your word, we are reminded that in the midst of challenging circumstances in our life, Lord, that you are not losing control. You've not lost your grip. Lord, you have, as the song says, you have the whole world in your hands. Father, I pray that as we read this psalm together, understand, Lord, what you are saying and apply the truth of what you've said to our lives. Father, I pray that we would leave here today comforted and encouraged and challenged, that no matter what we face, Lord, our prayer can be to lead us to a rock that is higher than I. Father, I pray, Lord, for myself this morning that I would decrease. Lord, I pray that Jesus would increase. Lord, I pray for your church. Lord, that each one of us would decrease, Lord, and forget about any idea of self-sufficiency, Lord, and we would depend on the all-sufficient one that is you. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. As we walk through Psalm 61 this morning, we're going to see David's cry to God. Then we'll see David's confidence in God. And then we'll close by seeing David's commitment to God. Let's begin in verse 1 with David's cry to God. Hear my cry, O God. Attend to my prayer. I've got a question this morning for the kids that are here. When you think of David, what comes to mind? Remington, what is it? I'm going to say he said Goliath. Let's just go with Goliath. When you think of David, you think of Goliath. We think of that man who killed Goliath. We think of this battle-tested warrior, this king. David was skillful in slinging stones. David was skillful in wielding a sword. Yet as you read through the Psalms, over and over again, we're reminded that David's weapon of choice was not a sling and a stone all the time. It was not a sword. It was his voice as he cried out to God in prayer. Here he is in verse 1. He's pleading with God. God, listen to me. Lord, please pay attention to me. And then look to the Bible in verse 2. From the end of the earth I will cry to you. When my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. Now David, if you go back and read in 2 Samuel, David was literally away from home. The rebellion that with his son had pushed him away from the kingdom, but he was literally away from home. But I want you to understand, the end of the earth is not based solely on geography. The end of the earth in this prayer can be a metaphor for spiritual distance. You see, you can be here in this sanctuary this morning, and because of circumstances, because of the overwhelming fear, whatever it might be that's come over you, you could feel as though you are crying out to God from the end of the earth. David cries to God, when my heart is overwhelmed. We can probably all relate to that moment in our life. We are overwhelmed with the circumstances we face. Our heart rate begins to pick up. We begin to feel a weight, a pressure upon our chest. The anxiety is building as we face this overwhelming situation. And David pleads with God, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. He's pleading with God. He wants to be taken to the spot, the position that God is in. He wants to be taken to the spot, to the position that only God can do. He wants to be taken to God because God is the only one that can meet David's need. And he says, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. That is a clear understanding. That is a rock we cannot get to on our own. We can try, we can try, we can try. God has to lead us to that rock. David was at a point in his life. He was at a point of one of many in his life when he was facing a challenge. He had a challenge come on him head on, and he had a choice to make in that moment. Would he rely on his own self-sufficiency to get through it? Or would he realize just exactly how insufficient he is and call upon the Lord. Think back to the prophet Jonah. Jonah was a real man who was told by God to go and preach to the Ninevites, repent, to take a message to them to turn from their sin. And you remember the story. Jonah said no, and he decided that he would not go. He got on a ship and went the opposite direction. God brought a severe storm upon that ship. The people there realized something was wrong. They came to the conclusion Jonah was the reason. He was cast overboard. As soon as Jonah hit the water, he went from self-sufficient to insufficient real quick. God used a real fish to swallow Jonah up. Miraculously, for 3 days and three nights, God kept a real man, Jonah, in the belly of a real fish. From inside the belly of that fish, Jonah cried out to God. God heard his prayer. And the Bible tells us in Jonah 2:10, so the Lord spoke to the fish, and it vomited Jonah onto dry land. Jonah and David each found themselves in situations, found themselves facing challenges. Their self-sufficiency was not going to cut it. They realized their insufficiency in those moments, and they cried out to God. Let me ask you this morning, has God brought you to a point where you have had to recognize your own insufficiency? My sister is both a mother and she also works in a school. I was talking with her last week and she's overwhelmed with the concerns of what this coming school year will look like. She doesn't know what she's going to do because not only does she work in the school and she's concerned about the health and safety of the kids, she's also concerned about the health and safety of her family. She's concerned about the impact COVID has had on these families, and she's concerned about how challenging it's going to be an educator in this new season. Maybe you're here this morning and you're facing a situation and you have concerns that are simply beyond your strength, beyond your reach. When your heart is overwhelmed, cry out to God. Cry out to Him just as the Balfour kids were reminded this week in their digital Sunday school. Call out to Him and cast all your care upon Him, for He cares for you. David recognized his insufficiency. He called out to an all-sufficient God. The reason he did this, look to your Bible in verse 3. David's confidence in God. That's what we're going to turn to next. David had confidence in God, and it was based on his experience. It was based on who God had been for him. Look to verse 3. For you have been a shelter for me, a strong tower from the enemy. Strong towers were put around the walls of a city. They would provide stability. They would allow for the city to be fortified. David knew God as a strong tower because in times of instability in his life, he knew God was stable. In times of confusion in his life, he knew God would provide clarity. Strong towers were placed in the walls of the city also for defense. David knew in times of battle that God would provide security, God would provide strength. The Bible says in Proverbs 18:10, the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run to it and are safe. God had been a shelter. God had been a strong tower. David had confidence in God. Next, we see David's confidence is based on what God will be for him. Verse 4, I will abide in your tabernacle forever. I will trust in the shelter of your wings. The tabernacle was that sacred tent in Jerusalem where they would gather to worship there in God's presence. David longed to be in God's presence. David prayed, I will trust in the shelter of your wings. There are many, many different illustrations used in the Bible for the protection and security that God provides. The shelter of your wings is one of the most applicable. It's one of the most relative, one of the most timely. Think of Ruth, David's great, great, great grandmother. She was a widower, or widowed in a foreign land. She sought safety and security in the Lord as she went to a member of her mother-in-law's family, a man by the name of Boaz. The Bible says in Ruth 2:12, "The Lord repay your work, and a full reward be given you by the Lord God of Israel, under whose wings you have come for refuge." Through the lineage of Boaz and Ruth would come David. Through the lineage of Boaz and Ruth would come Jesus, just as God had promised. Jesus, the one who would pay the ultimate price of redemption for our sins. Jesus, the one who would die on the cross for our sins, was buried and rose again the third day. It was Jesus who went to the cross for us, and by his death and resurrection, we have salvation from sin and deliverance from death. David desired to be in God's presence. He desired the shelter, the safety that only God could provide. At the end of verse 4, the Psalms were typically sung. So by the time they get to the end of verse 4, there would be a pause, be an opportunity for them to reflect on what they had just sung, be reminded to cry out to God, be reminded of how good God had been, will be, and is to them. David moves on in verse 5, and he bases his confidence again on what God has done for him. The Bible says, "For you, O God, have heard my vows. You have given me the heritage of those who fear your name." As David prayed to God, a peace came over him. Have you ever been in that spot where you're just overwhelmed with the challenges? You sit down and you pray to God, and a peace comes over you as you know that you don't have to handle this all by yourself. David had peace that God had heard his prayer. David had peace that God would act upon his prayer according to God's perfect will. That word heritage refers both to the promise of land that was made beginning in Genesis to Abraham, but it also points to the benefits of being in a covenant relationship with God, of being close to God. We're in, as a believers, in the new covenant, a relationship that is secured by the shed blood of Christ. David knew what it was like to have a covenant with God, to have that relationship with God. He writes in Psalm 37:34, "Wait on the Lord and keep his way, and he shall exalt you to inherit the land. When the wicked are cut off, you shall see it." David is confident in what God has done for him. He moves again now to verse 6, expressing further confidence in what God will do. Look to your Bible, verse 6. "You will prolong the king's life, his years as many generations." David is praying for his life to be lengthened. He doesn't want to see it end in this present battle. David is also praying for the continuation of the Davidic monarchy, the promise God made that the Messiah would come through the line of David. David is praying that this would continue. It's made clear in verse 7. Look to your Bible. "He shall abide before God forever. Oh, prepare mercy and truth, which may preserve him." The Lord had established a covenant with David that Jesus, the Messiah, the one who would come to save his people from their sin, would come through the line of David. The Lord had promised this continuation would last well beyond David. The very promises of God are fulfilled in Jesus. the one the angel of the Lord told Mary in Luke chapter 1, "And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Highest, and the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. And of his kingdom there will be no end." David expressed confidence that God would fulfill his promises based on God's mercy, his unfailing love for his people. David expressed his confidence in God based on God's truth, God's faithfulness in his character, and his faithfulness to his word. If God has said it, we can trust it. Think for a moment about David's confidence. As I thought about the confidence David placed in the Lord, it reminded me of Peter. In Matthew chapter 14, Peter is on a boat with the other disciples. Jesus had sent them on their way by themselves, and it was now sometime after 3 o'clock in the morning. The disciples are there on the boat, and they see Jesus approaching. Jesus is walking on the water. Peter calls out to Jesus. He wants to join him on the water, and Jesus says, "Come." Now, you probably know the story. Peter stepped out onto the water. The wind picks up. Peter becomes fearful, begins to sink. Jesus reaches out his hand and rescues Peter. Now, many sermons have been preached about Peter's lack of faith in that moment. And Jesus says something to Peter about his lack of faith, asking him, why did he doubt? However, let me say, 11 other people stayed in the boat. Peter got out onto the water. And furthermore, as I read this passage again this week, I was reminded, as Peter began to sink, he didn't use it as an opportunity to show off his swimming skills. Why? Because Peter didn't have confidence in himself. When Peter began to sink, he didn't yell back to his brother Andrew and the other disciples in the boat, asking them to rescue him. Why? Because Peter didn't put his confidence in others. Peter called out to the Lord. He called out to Jesus and he said, "Lord, save me." And why did he do that? Because Peter had placed his confidence in the Lord. Just the same way David had cried out to God. Why did David cry out to God? Because David was confident it was God, and only God, who could rescue him. Consider for a moment the most pressing challenge that you're facing. Now, we know as we come together as a church family on Sunday morning, there's some that we may know a little bit about what's going on through the prayer text and everything else. There's others that folks are coming in with challenges they have faced that week that may be beyond pale. We can't even begin to think about what they have faced. Consider the most pressing challenge that's weighing in on your mind. The one that when I, a few moments ago, began to talk about your heartbeat picking up, the pressure coming in on your chest, that challenge in your life. As you face that challenge, where have you placed your confidence? Have you placed it in yourself? Have you placed it in others? Or have you placed it in the Lord, the only one who can preserve us in mercy and truth? Whatever challenge lies before you, remember the truth of Proverbs 3. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him, and He shall direct your path. David has cried out to God. He is confident that God, who God was, and what He had done for David. He had the utmost confidence in God's ability to meet his need in this present challenge. So we'll close this morning by seeing David's commitment to God. Look to your Bible, verse 8. So I will sing praise to your name forever, that I may daily perform my vows. David was thankful to God for his protection. David was thankful that God had heard his prayer. David was thankful that God would answer his prayer according to his perfect will. David vowed to walk faithfully with God, day after day after day. David vowed to walk faithfully with God, not merely on the day that he received that prayer, but over and over each day of his life. Wedding vows are not only for the day that they are made. On October 7th, 2006, Stacy and I made a series of vows before God, before one another, before our family and our friends. The vows we made were to have and to hold from this day forward, for better or for worse, for sickness and in health, for good times and in bad. When we returned from our honeymoon, my first day back at work, my boss came up to me and he said, "Hey, I'm sorry, but I'm closing the business down. You're going to be out of work in a month." Now, as I went back to Stacy, she didn't look at me and say, "You know, he was at our wedding. Why didn't he tell us on October 7th when I made that vow? I would have kept it then, but now I'm going back. I'm going back to live with my mom and dad." You're on your own. You see, that vow was made on October 7th, but that vow continues. As we've experienced through family, emotional, physical, spiritual challenges, our commitment to honor those vows is daily, day after day after day. David vowed to give testimony to God daily. You know, there's sometimes that you see folks go through a real challenging time in their life. And you know by the way they handle it, you know by the confidence they've placed in God, and you see it in them during and after, they're giving testimony to the Lord. They are shining a bright light on Jesus as the one who got them through. Each one of us desires to walk with the Lord. That should be true in our life. As we cry out to God, as we place our confidence in Him, and He delivers us through whatever challenge it might be, we're to shine a bright light on who He is and what He's done. David was committed to God day after day. Not perfect. Read through 1 and 2 Samuel. Read through the Psalms. You'll see he was not a perfect man. There's only one that's ever been perfect, and that's Jesus. But David was committed to God. I'd ask you this morning, how would you describe your commitment to God? Is it steady and solid, or is it weak and wavering? Are you walking closely with God, or are you wandering carelessly in the ways of this world? Paul instructed Timothy in 1 Timothy 4, verse 16, "Take heed to yourself and to your doctrine. Continue in them." The instructions there are clear. Pay close attention to your life and your walk with the Lord. Pay close attention to what you believe. Psalm 61 provides a great example and a great reminder for each one of us to cry out to God in prayer. You see, as we cry out to God in prayer, it serves as a great reminder to each one of us of our insufficiency to handle the challenges that we face every day. As we cry out to God in prayer, it reminds us of the importance of our dependence upon God, the only one who is all sufficient, the only one that can help us through life's challenges. When you are overwhelmed with whatever it is you're facing, cry out to Jesus in prayer. He will listen. He will give you the strength to face that challenge. He says in 2 Corinthians 12:9, "My grace is sufficient for you, for my strength is made perfect in weakness." Psalm 61 provides a great reminder that the He, and He's got the whole world in His hands, isn't me. It's not you. It's God. Pray and ask God, because He is the one who is the strong tower. He is the one who is the shelter. He is the one who is the refuge. He is the one who can lead you to a rock that is higher than I. The only true security we can have, the only true shelter we can hope to find, is in the shelter of His wings. And as you cry out to God, as you find and renew your strength and confidence in Him, remember the promise He makes to us in Philippians 4. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your request be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Each one of us, on a daily basis, faces challenges. There are times those challenges hit us square in the face, and we stumble around not knowing where to turn. We're shown here in the Scripture to cry out to God, to turn to Him. He is the shelter. He is the strong tower. No matter what we face, He is the one in whom we must find our refuge. Let's pray this morning. Almighty God, we thank You. Lord, we thank You for who You are. Father, we know that because You live, Lord, just as we sang earlier, because You live, we can face tomorrow. Lord, I know, Lord, that without Your grace, without Your strength, I couldn't make it another moment. But Father, forgive me for those times in which I don't believe that to be true. Father, forgive me for the times that I depend on my own self-sufficiency. Lord, and I try to navigate the daily challenges of life in my own strength and in my own power. Lord, forgive me for being so self-sufficient. Father, help me to be reminded that You are the all-sufficient one. Father, help us as a church, Lord, to depend on Your sufficiency. Father, help us as a church to guard and navigate our steps after You. Lord, help each one of us to not have a desire to step forward unless we know You are with us. And Lord, as we face the challenges that we'll face, Lord, help us to be reminded that You are a strong tower. Lord, lead us to the strong tower. Lead us to the rock that is taller than I. In Jesus' name, amen.